Good evening and welcome to the 31st Schonland lecture and the third one of the year. It's a pleasure to see such a well-supported lecture, and that probably says much about tonight's lecturer, Rick van Heerden. Before I start tonight's proceedings, I thought I'd like to just very quickly reflect on the Schonlands for this year. As most of you know, the lecture has always been something very special to me. As an entity, it was one of the first things that I fell in love with at both schools. I'd like to acknowledge three groups of people tonight, and for the role that they've played in this year's, or the series of Schonlands that have gone throughout the year. Firstly, there are a group of students who somehow have made up my English class, and they have supported this lecture throughout the series of lectures throughout the year. And I'd like to thank them for their attendance and for their investment in this. I'd like to say one thing, which is university is like this, but it's like this all the time, and you're going to love it. So thank you. I'd also like to thank Mr. Stuart Watson for his role as Chief Sherry Pourer. All of this, it's his willingness to help wherever and whenever, and for that I'm most grateful. Thank you, Mrs. Stuart Watson. Lastly, and I think it's an appropriate time, if you look back to the very first Schonland lecture, you will see that it was given by Mr. Smith, and it was entitled Understanding Quantum Society. Now, my very rudimentary of the term quantum society is, from what I've pieced together, as follows. Quantum societies seek social harmony built upon tolerance, mutual respect, and the celebration of diversity. Quantum societies need conversations that are quantum in nature. In other words, quantum societies need conversations that are considerable, substantial, important, significant, consequential. If you look at all of those lectures, the ones that have preceded Mr. Smith's first talk, I believe that what he has done has been to organize and facilitate a quantum society right here. And I think that's amazing. Also, if you look at that first poster, it appears to be like an ever-growing wave, like the woodblock print, the great wave of Kanagawa. Now, I'm not very good with physics, but I am an average surfer, and I do feel that I can speak about and evaluate waves. Waves are energy, and they propel surfers depending on the wave size and the energy contained in it. I think visually there is a real beauty to having a wave cresting in the first Schonland and then seeing what it has propelled and given rise to subsequently. Now, when I first arrived at St. Andrews, I came to the former headmaster Paul Eadie's Schonland lecture, and Mr. Smith introduced Mr. Eadie. In that introduction, he said Mr. Eadie could not have left as headmaster without doing a Schonland. I think, as Mr. Smith wraps up this year, it would be fitting if he could give us one last Schonland lecture. But alas, much has conspired to mean that is largely impossible this year. But I do think Schonland lectures give people the opportunity to reflect and to think about and to plot the way forward. And so, inspired by what my children are reading at the moment, some Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, what I would like to give to Mr. Smith is, just like Willy Wonka, a golden ticket for him to use whenever he so wishes to do a Schonland of his choice. to tonight's lecture. In introducing Rick, I'd like to thank Johan Pretorius for sourcing the following biographical detail. Rick van Heerden was born in Zimbabwe in 1959. His father liked Fats Waller, and his brother liked Dave Brubeck and Quincy Jones. Rick took up the clarinet and saxophone and was a keen actor at school, where he also played in his first band. In 1977, he came to South Africa and studied music at Rhodes University with Norbert Nowotny. He then studied with Darius Brubeck and Kevin Vollens at the University of Natal, where he majored in jazz studies. His thesis was on Miles Davis, and he went on to do a master's thesis on Paul Desmond. For many years, he worked as a musician in Durban, Johannesburg, and Harare, where his band, with Steve Dyer, opened for Eric Clapton. He worked with an array of jazz and rock musicians, including James Phillips, Mark Duby, Kevin Gibson, Lula Kotsana, Chris Letcher, Brendan Jury, Roger Bachy, and Jethro Sasher. He toured the United States with a student band and toured Europe with his own band from Zimbabwe. He has performed extensively throughout Southern Africa, including Namibia, Angola, and Mozambique, and he performed with drummer Michael Baird in Holland. Rick writes music and has a liking for both minimalism and noisy and chaotic improvisation. His bands have gone by picturesque names such as the Structural Adjusters, The Raw Uncooked, and Rick Random and the Riot. He has appeared frequently at the National Arts Festival and has performed with the Eastern Cape Big Band and local bands Random Planet, Sunship, and Sabine, as well as with the roster of local musicians that over the years has included Larry Strelitz, Gareth Warwin, Chris Thorpe, Kingsley Batendach, Steve Ellis, Nishtan Romana, John Edwards, Mike Bester, Matt Sabine, who's here tonight and also a fellow Schonland lecturer, and Jeffrey and Andrew Tracy. Rick taught at the Zimbabwe College of Music and has been teaching at DSG since 1994. He has done part-time lecturing at Rhodes University. He is interested in history and philosophy, and apparently he makes a huge mess when he cooks, which is often. Rick is one of the great characters of our two schools, and it is my absolute pleasure that he is now going to be one of only two teachers who have delivered multiple Schonland lectures. And of course, as Ben Terry put his finger on it, he said, how many Schonland lectures have dealt with music? And of course, this is going to be the first. Over to Rick.
To share some music with you. You're my captive audience, but I hope it's worth your while. I tried to create a kind of, I tried to create a vibe as you all came in by playing some tracks from these and other albums, and at this stage I just want to introduce Mr. Matt Sabine. He is my sound designer. And as Joe pointed out, he is no stranger to these shores, and he actually gave a Schonland lecture himself many years ago. Matt, thank you so much. I don't have to hassle about technical things. Okay. The music that was playing as people were coming in and sipping their sherry is culled from a whole range of albums that were very big in the 1970s. These are some of them. These did very well commercially. When I was a student, your people who had record collections, self-respecting music fans would in all likelihood have one or more of these albums, plus of course a whole kind of range of other stuff in their records. However, even though this represents the kind of the most popular trajectory of jazz rock, that's not really my concern. I'll freeze this. Jazz, this was the cover of Newsweek from 1977. Jazz enjoyed a significant revival thanks to the kind of music that we've just been listening to. It seemed to gain an audience that jazz had somehow lost. Now, the evolution and history of jazz is quite complex and quite interesting. But at a certain juncture in the 1940s, there emerged an idiom called bebop. Now, bebop was self-consciously and deliberately elitist. And from that time onwards, there was a kind of bifurcation in the way jazz developed. Basically, jazz stopped being a dance music. It stopped being the kind of music that people enjoyed and listened to, and effectively kind of painted itself into a corner. And it was thanks to jazz rock that it kind of emerged from the shadows. That's Herbie Hancock. We're not going to listen to him, unfortunately. There's Wayne Shorter. We're going to listen to a lot of him. That's Stanley Clarke. Won't be listening to him. But by 1977, jazz rock had kind of entrenched itself and was widely known. But as I say, I'm not really considering that side of jazz rock, the commercial side. I have other things I want to consider. Jazz rock is a bit of a misnomer. Possibly the music of someone like John McLaughlin, a wailing electric guitarist who we're going to hear something of. He was very rockish, and there were certain bands like Blood, Sweat and Tears of Chicago who were essentially rock bands, and they incorporated jazz elements into what they did. But it's jazz rock, and especially its incarnations that I'm going to look at tonight, was certainly much more complex than a simple title would indicate. There were other names for the music like fusion and crossover, somewhat pejorative terms. Not everyone agreed or approved of this popular turn the jazz had taken. In fact, at UCT, which had the leading jazz faculty in the country, I don't know what the current status of jazz rock is, but certainly up until a few years ago, jazz rock wasn't even considered as part of the curriculum. It was kind of beyond the pale. This is really my concern for tonight. I know in the publicity there's been a lot of talk about jazz and popular culture. That was my original kind of thinking, but then I kind of narrowed it down. We're not going to be looking at the popular side of jazz rock. We're going to be looking, for want of a better word, the more experimental, perhaps avant-garde side of jazz rock, and to my mind, the most artistically valuable. And I will be focusing exclusively on Miles Davis and Weather Report. Now, for me personally, the issue boils down to this, the cult of the soul. Now, I'm sure all of you have had experience of jazz. Jazz has been quite big at the festival for a number of years. But I spoke about jazz painting itself into a corner, and I think this is the problem. And as I said earlier, this goes back to bebop. You are familiar with the procedure. They all come on stage, they all play the tune, they all play together, and then the front line leave the stage, and there's just a succession of solos. Then everyone comes back on stage to play the theme out. And the whole focus of the exercise is the improvised solo. Now, the music we're going to listen to tonight departs from that. It is a challenge to the cult of the solo, which is quite possibly why it is frowned upon and was frowned upon in certain circles. I mean, there are other reasons as well. There will be one improvised solo that we're going to focus on tonight by Miles Davis. That will be our first example. But even then, it's a little bit more complicated than, oh well, the band has played the theme and now we're going to have a succession of solos. And we're going to look at that. We're going to look at how more interesting it became. Okay, jazz rock general characteristics. Jazz musicians adopt grooves associated with funk and rock. I'll explain what a groove is later. Suffice to say that there were a whole lot of exciting things happening in the music world in the late 60s and 70s, and jazz musicians drew on new developments in the world of popular music. That's why jazz and popular culture are intertwined. Now, what do we mean by the groove changing? I'll explain that. I've got a slide coming up. But in a basic way, the walking bass, which we really associate with jazz, you've got the bass player with a huge bass, and he's walking along, and we call that swing. There's a walking bass in swing music, and in most jazz, it is intimately associated with jazz as an idiom. Okay, well, in jazz rock, you don't hear that anymore. You don't hear the subdivision of the beat into three, with an implied triplet subdivision of the beat. We're going back to kind of march time, where the beat subdivides into four semiquavers, which are generally articulated on the hi-hat, and we'll come to that. A very important new technology, use of electric instruments, electric guitar, electric bass, electronic keyboard instruments, particularly synthesizers, and studio technology. These all become very important. And improvisation is not always a priority. I've got five musical examples. The first one will feature an improvised solo by Miles Davis. The last three won't contain any improvisation at all. Or there will be touches of improvisation. There'll be a little improvised interlude here and there. But in the music we're considering tonight, improvisation is not a priority. It's not the main thrust of what is happening musically. Okay. Popular culture, I talk about jazz, drawing on popular culture. These musicians are very important. Miles Davis attended a concert by Jimi Hendrix. He went with his longtime collaborator, Gil Evans. He was absolutely speechless. I'm not sure what year that was, but Hendrix left a huge impression on Miles Davis. Miles Davis started adopting you won't hear it tonight, but in the mid-70s, he started using electronic effects like wah-wah and stuff on his trumpet, and he was directly inspired by Hendrix. He has a great classic pic of Hendrix at Woodstock. James Brown, godfather of soul and the godfather of funk, he stands behind a whole range of musical developments in the 60s, including the music of Sly Stone, who was a huge influence on Herbie Hancock, for example. So these are some of the musicians that were very current. So now, there again, you see, when we're talking about rock, I'm not talking about the Beatles or the Rolling Stones or the Who. I'm talking explicitly about African-American popular music and in particular, an idiom called funk, which was pioneered by James Brown. Also very important was Ravi Shankar. Indian music became very fashionable around about this time. Famously, George Harrison embraced it, but so did a lot of the musicians we're going to hear tonight. John McLaughlin, the guitarist, was hugely influenced by Ravi Shankar. You can hear that in his playing, the way he bends notes. And in our first musical example, we're going to hear a drone. A drone is a kind of just a sort of a long note. It is associated with folk music and, of course, bagpipes. If you want to know what a drone is, just before the pipe band take to the field on speech day, you will hear them pumping their bags up and they'll be like, and that's a drone. And Indian music also uses drones. Okay, but here's a technical explanation of a groove. This is kind of sort of quite academic. Okay. Now, I imagine most of you are pretty familiar with non-classical music. One of the things that differentiates classical music, Western classical music, from other kinds of music is the primacy of the groove. The groove is a kind of, is the rhythmic underpinning. And in the best of African-American music, it is very complicated. And you've got layers of polyrhythms, and it's very interesting. But in Western classical music, we're used to a kind of succession of events. Now, people who are new to African American music think, yeah, but you know, like this is just going on, you know, nothing's really happening. And that is the point. That is the point. There's something, I suppose, trance-like. Remember, traditional African music is intimately associated with rituals and religious rituals of various kinds. And this, I think it's useful to try to understand African-American music, even if it's not kind of religiously orientated in those ways. The groove, you won't hear this the whole time tonight. Certainly the last track, the two Miles Davis tracks, they involve a groove. It's something that you've got to feel. A groove can just go on. A good groove can go on for a long time, and people who understand the groove won't be bothered. They won't be hankering for something more. It's as if the groove is kind of complete. But now what's interesting about jazz is that you have very solid grooves laid down by superb musicians, and then on top of that, you have a whole lot of interesting stuff happening as well. And there will be interaction between the rhythm section who carry the groove and the rest of the band. Okay, this is a good example of an electronic instrument, the Fender Rhodes electric piano. You're going to hear a lot of that tonight. Sounds a bit like a vibraphone. Keyboard players were very excited when this came onto the market in the late 60s and early 70s. And this is a good example of the kind of electronic instrument that was prevalent in jazz rock. Okay, this is what do I really want to get at? I've got various poles outlined here. I've got improvisation, I've got composition. Improvisation is where you make up stuff on the spot. Composition is where it's kind of worked out in advance. Jazz traditionally emphasizes this and is obsessed with improvisation and particularly solos. There's some jazz rock that was about that. Not that one so much, but these guys, these are the guys we were listening to as everyone came in. This is the kind of popular side of the idiom. Here at the bottom, you've got bands that incorporated improvisation into what they did, but it wasn't the sole focus of what was happening. That's why here it's in a corner between popular and composition. And then people like Herbie Hancock and the Mahavishnu Orchestra, very important musicians. I won't get to them tonight, alas. They kind of stand somewhere in between. They feature very interesting compositions, but also there's a lot of improvising going on. Soft Machine as well. But this is really what I'm looking at. I'm looking at, on the one hand, Miles Davis, for whom improvisation was very important, but in novel ways. And then Weather Report, who as a band, as they developed, slowly but surely improvisation became less and less important. Weather Report was founded by Joe Zawinul and Wayne Shorter, who both played with Miles Davis. They started off, like Miles, quite interested in improvisation, even free improvisation. That is where, like, you know, you're limiting the number of parameters that you rely on within which improvisation can take place. But as the band developed, as their sound matured, so they became increasingly oriented towards composition, towards music that was predetermined, worked out in advance, and often didn't have any improvised solos or improvisation at all. Okay, this is just a little aside. Does anyone recognize this? The Soft Machine were a very important jazz rock band emphasizing composition. Does anyone recognize this? Who's in the choir? No, okay. This is Carl Jenkins. The choir has featured his compositions, his choral compositions, I know, over the years. So he started off with Soft Machine, and Howard Shore, the composer for Lord of the Rings and much else, he played saxophone with Lighthouse. Right, let's get going. Talking too much already. Okay, we're going to check out some Miles Davis. We're going to check out two excerpts from Miles Davis from two albums. The one was In a Silent Way, and the other one was Pitcher's Brew. They are generally regarded as being the two albums that really ushered in this new idiom of jazz rock. Now, of course, Miles Davis was no stranger to doing new things and innovating. He was involved with bebop, with Charlie Parker. He was involved in cool jazz, with Gil Evans. He was involved in hard bop. He helped usher in modal improvisation with an album called Kind of Blue. So Miles Davis was a tireless innovator. And towards in the late 60s, he embraced jazz rock in two albums. And they became landmark albums. That's not to say that Miles Davis was the only person who was kind of, you know, doing this kind of thing. But he certainly became the figurehead for the new movement. That's Dave Holland, the bass player. That's the late Chick Corea, who died not that long ago. There's Miles Davis. This is a later picture of Miles Davis. Okay, as you can tell, Miles was a natty dresser. In fact, there's a great story, a little anecdote I have to share with you. Albums, many of you won't know this, but I mean, albums came out like in vinyl, and the records were contained in sleeves, you know, about this size. And the sleeves contained, you know, had on the one hand, like, you know, sort of very often impressive cover art. We checked out some of those album covers earlier. And then on the other side, there were what became known as liner notes. Now, Ralph J. Gleason was a writer, a frequent contributor for Rolling Stone, the magazine, which is still going. And he wrote the liner notes for In a Silent Way. We're going to hear some stuff from In a Silent Way now. And he went to town. He spoke in glowing terms about Miles Davis's dress sense, his superb taste, the way he would wear this, and the way he would wear this, and he waxed lyrical about how Miles Davis was this kind of, just represented this height of sartorial elegance. And so the liner notes go on. This is on the back of an album, you know, with music. And the liner notes go on, he's carrying on about what Miles Davis wears this, he wears this. And then right at the end, the final line of the liner notes is, "Oh, by the way, Miles Davis also plays trumpet." Okay, let's check out some of Miles' trumpet play from In a Silent Way. Okay. Let me explain how Miles went about things. Miles Davis, throughout this period, and for a period extending well into the 1970s, before he went into semi-retirement, had a certain procedure, a certain technique when he recorded. He would choose his musicians, very important, his sidemen, as we call them. He would go into the studio, and his band would play. And they would play. And they would just improvise, often for hours on end. I'm told that to this day, Columbia Records still has hours of unreleased material recorded by Miles Davis and his band. And they would just improvise. So just remember, you know, I was talking about improvisation up here and composition down here. When it came to jazz rock as an idiom, Miles Davis was also really, he was forefronting improvisation in a big way. Possibly this was the influence of free jazz and the avant-garde, but Miles Davis's performances for about 8 years, his albums were, there would be some stuff that has worked out in advance, but generally he would turn to the band and ask them to produce a groove. There's that word again. And on some albums, you can even hear him talking to his band and kind of cajoling them and giving them instructions. So for Miles, it was very much a kind of live exercise, the complete antithesis of what Weather Report would do a few years ago. Okay, jazz rock, different styles of jazz are characterized by the utilization of different parts of the drum kit. Funk uses this, hard bop uses the snare on 2 and 4, swing jazz uses the bass drum on every beat, like disco. Jazz, bebop traditionally uses the ride cymbal. What we're going to hear in this next track is the use of the hi-hat. Semi-quavers on every beat. And that's really the kind of the center of the groove. A little bit later with Weather Report, we'll hear the use of the ride as well. Okay, now this is very important. This is interesting. I talk about Miles just going into the studio and he's just playing and they are recording. Now, Taylor McKira, that's fine. Thanks, Miles. I've got hours and hours of your music. It doesn't have any beginning, it doesn't have any end. The music's just there, the improvising. Now, Taylor McKira, he is responsible to a fellow called Clive Davis, who's the CEO of Columbia Records. Now, Clive, of course, I mean, he wasn't an accountant. I mean, it's not like today where, you know, music is commercial beyond recognition. But obviously, you know, he was a business person and he was mindful of, like, you know, the fact that, well, you know, people had to buy the records. So Taylor McKerry says, okay, this is fine. I've got all this hours of Miles jamming. But now he felt he had to do something with it. And apparently Miles Davis was very generous in this respect. Miles Davis, as far as he was concerned, when he left the studio, his job was done. And he was quite happy to hand things over. Taylor McKerry was like a collaborator, a close collaborator, much like Bill Evans in a previous, in the 1950s, and much like Marcus Miller, the bass player, in the 1990s. They had a very good relationship, and Miles trusted McKerry. Now, what did McKerry do? He said, okay, he was confronted with this, these long stretches of improvisation, and he's thinking, okay, I've got to do something with this. I've got to make this presentable to the public. So he did a bit of cheating using the technology at his disposal. What we're going to hear now is the opening of In a Silent Way. But what is interesting is that you will hear 5 minutes. I'm not going to play the whole track. The whole track is about 17 minutes. But right at the end, what we hear at the beginning reappears again, verbatim, as it were. And Taylor McKira has, using the technology of the time, which, you know, which involved magnetic tapes, he literally would, like, Matt would be able to explain this better than I can, but he would literally splice. He would do the equivalent then of what we would now call cutting and pasting, or copying and pasting. And he copied the beginning of this track and pasted it on at the end. And he did more than that. You'll hear a little bit of it. If you listen to the tracks in their entirety, there's a lot of it. And scholars have even gone onto YouTube. You know, they're quite keen to point this out, the role of what studio editing in the formation of these crucial recordings by Miles Davis, where the producer becomes very important. In addition to the cutting, the copying and pasting, and the cutting and pasting, also, you'll hear how sometimes, you know, the rhythm section will drop out, or this instrument will drop out. Very much along the lines of today's electronic dance music, where exactly the same thing is happening. We call this mixing. You know, so you might have five tracks, say drums, bass, keys, vocals, whatever. Now, at any given moment, they might all be playing. Then, you know, the DJ comes along and you'll just drop out the bass, or you'll drop out the drums, and Taylor McKira is doing quite a lot of that. Right. This is what I'm talking about. This is the theme, so-called inverted commas theme, or In a Silent Way. But of course, it's not a theme at all. It's never intended as a theme. Taylor McKira made it into a theme. It was originally improvised. So we'll hear this. Notice also now we have a very simple bass ostinato. Down and top. Boom, 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 boom. talking about ostinato, I never explained an ostinato. For those of you who at today's lunch hour concert, there was a piece by Roman Hart, played very skillfully by Ben Terry and Cornelie Rocher. This was a piece that utilized ostinato extensively. It's very much a fast use of ostinato. It's very much a kind of contemporary technique. Arguably going back to Ravel's Bolero, which was like kind of an exercise in repetition and use of ostinato. Here we have a very simple ostinato. By the time we get to Weather Report right at the end, we have bass lines that are quite much more complex. Now, this is the theme, improvised. I just want to draw your attention to those of you who are scholars, but I mean, those of you who are music scholars, but still pick it up. Rests. Here we've got like what? Over two bars rest, almost three bars rest. Miles Davis makes a pronouncement, then he just parts off. Ba-da-ba-da-ba-ba. Little section. Keyboards bubbling away. Miles parks off. And he says, okay, then. Parks off again. This is an aspect, this has always been a part of Miles' style. If you hear his classic recording of Summertime with Gil Evans, it's very similar. He uses lots of gaps in his play. He's not hurried. He's very kind of very considered in his approach. And we hear this in this track. Okay, I think it's time for me to shut up. And we're going to listen now to the opening of Spiesel from the 1969 album In a Silent Way. This was one of the albums that helped usher in jazz rock as a real kind of artistic and commercial force. Matt? Thank you. Notice, of course, Miles Davis's own unique, inimitable, laconic style. He's what we would call a motivic improviser. Chaps, most of the jazz improvisation you hear today, and this is not criticism, it's actually an indictment, is full of scales, ostentation, and empty displays of technical virtuosity. This is thanks to bebop. In Miles Davis, you don't hear any of that. Everything is just pared down. He's a supremely intelligent, considered player. But notice also how, I mean, you know, the trumpet solo is foregrounded to an extent. But boy, you're never going to get away from this kind of, this sort of bubbling, ecstatic kind of accompaniment. And of course, this lovely kind of shimmering texture. This is like sort of kind of hippie music par excellence. This is zone art music. This is a beautiful album. I just want to say the title track, Inner Side of Way, written by Joe Zawinul, contains no improvisation at all. There's a drone that goes the whole way through, and the various soloists take turns in playing the theme, and that's it. This wasn't new in Miles Davis's 1967 album Nefertiti, the title track, similarly. The theme is just repeated over and over. So already there is a move away from improvisation. So on the one hand, we've got the revival of collective improvisation, a collective ethos. So it's not just Miles soloing. You've got this kind of constant hubbub created by the keyboards and the guitar. And in this next track, you're going to hear this even to greater and rather disturbing effect. Let's move on to this album. portions of the cover art I used in my poster. This is a fabulous cover. Notice the afro kind of morphing into a tornado, and I mean, weather report. Where did Zawinul and Shorter get their the name for their band? And you just think, well, look at this and the ocean and stuff. I'll show you the whole cover, the back cover as well. Beautiful cover, very evocative. There's Miles looking customarily elegant. But what we're going to hear now, okay, there's the rest, whoopsie, there's the rest of the album. A kind of a voodoo priestess looking rather sinister. You'll see that these two are kind of mirror images of each other. In much the same way, In a Silent Way and Bitches Brew were kind of mirror images of each other. They corresponded to two aspects of the hippie movement and the 60s. On the one hand, you've got the idealism, the flower power, the psychedelia, H. Ashbury, Woodstock, and so forth. And then on the other hand, you've got Altamont, the notorious Woodstock, which went wrong. There was someone was murdered, and there was a very ugly atmosphere. The Hell's Angels were called in to keep order, but of course, you know, their role to this day is just disputed. There's a superb film called Gimme Shelter, which was featured on the festival a few years ago, which documents that. It's almost as if In a Silent Way and Bitches Brew kind of reflect these two sides of the 60s. The one very idealistic, very beautiful, and the other rather dark. Bitches Brew is a rather dark album. The overall aesthetic is very similar to In a Silent Way, but it's not half as gentle. It's not half as relaxed. And in this next track, you're going to hear that. Okay, we listened to the beginning of Peaceful. Now we're going to hear the end of Pharaoh's Dance. This is actually a composition by Joe Zawinul. We're going to hear more of Joe Zawinul. He was the organist on this last track. He rose to prominence. He was Austrian. He was Viennese born. He rose to prominence with Cannonball Adderley's band, and then joined Miles Davis, and then went on to form Weather Report. Very interesting composer. Now, this is the theme to Pharaoh's Dance. The theme only appears right at the end. Normally, in jazz performance, the theme is announced at the beginning, then you have a succession of solos, and then you have the theme right at the end. This didn't happen. Whether this was Taylor McCarroll's editing, I don't know, but it's certainly very effective. The tracks are, it's improvisatory right towards the end. And you're kind of thinking, sure, okay, this is great, but now where is this all going? And it's all going towards this. Right in the closing moments, the last few minutes of the track, it's an 18-minute performance, Miles comes in with Zawinul's theme. It's a very interesting theme. First of all, notice the use of wide intervals, which generally in tonal music are synonymous with kind of expressiveness. You know, Gregorian chant proceeds very smoothly by step. Expressionistic music, the music of Schoenberg and Webern, you know, jumps around a whole lot. And you can see this, wide intervals used in the melody. I was puzzling what, I'm going to get to a little bit technical now, what is the basis? What was the basis? Okay, you've got this, in the previous track, it was pretty clear, you had a kind of a D Mixolydian vibe, a few kind of blues notes played to effect. This is much, much more difficult to pin down. I thought originally that these notes might be extracted from a diminished scale, this diminished scale starting on B, but I mean, there are some notes in the theme that don't appear in the diminished scale at all. Also quite interesting, notice how a kind of D tonality is hinted at, that this is over a B pedal. And yeah, you've got a C natural, so you can't explain this as a B9. I mean, they really are, we are entering very interesting musical territory now. I always fancied that I heard kind of atonality and serialism in this theme. And I came up with this. Funny enough, I introduced my 11s today to tone rows. Tone rows and serialism, this was a compositional technique pioneered in Vienna before World War I. And it is quite, it is not beyond possibility that Salvador had absorbed this music. After all, he was from Vienna himself, only moved to the United States in the 60s. So he would have been very familiar with the various facets of Viennese cultural history and music. A tone row is where you have all notes within the octave appearing just once, and then you kind of start all over again. These aren't 12 tone rows, but you can see, look, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 notes without repetition. And here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 notes. It wouldn't be too fanciful to say that this is kind of, this is approaching a tonality. It certainly sounds very, very, very chromatic to my ears. See what you think. Now, notice also the way Miles Davis, he's, typically, when jazz musicians today play the theme, they'll just play it literally. Miles, when he did Summertime, for example, he wasn't doing that, and he wasn't doing it here either. I mean, this is just an approximation, and one of the ways in which he simply repeats this theme, I think it's about 4 times, but each time quite sort of very subtle, and this is the theme that's only appearing right at the end. There'll be lots of motivic references to it in the course of the track, and it's almost as if now suddenly this is the kind of release, but it's not literal. The way Miles Davis plays this theme, again a theme in inverted commas, is very loose and very improvisatory. Okay, Matt, let's go. Thank you. Listen to it more and more, you know, put the lights out late evening and allow yourself to be transported. This is very evocative music, but notice how busy it is. Miles Davis and these recordings revived collective improvisation, which effectively had died with New Orleans jazz. It had been restored by the avant-garde, but this is one of the most interesting aspects of these two albums. The keyboards and the guitar, and here joined by the bass clarinet, just going mull. And then Davis, like, just on top, kind of, you know, just playing this kind of haunting theme. Okay. That is the kind of the most radical the jazz rock got. Now, a very interesting thing happened. All right. Here we go. these two musicians, Joe Zawinul and Wayne Shorter, they left Miles Davis's group and they formed this band, Weather Report. This is the band in its most sort of famous incarnation. Peter Erskine on drums and notoriously Jaco Pastorius on bass. There you can see him in characteristically sort of wild mode, Zawinul looking very intent. Now, they did something completely different. There's Jaco Pastorius. Pastorius revolutionized the electric bass. He played a fretless bass, which allowed him to kind of slide around a lot. But he established his reputation with Weather Report. On a musical level, one of the interesting things that Weather Report accomplished was to liberate the bass. And you hear the electric bass, you know, really coming to the fore. And you'll hear it to good effect in this next track. There's Joe Zawinul. This is very important. Look, these are all his toys, his synths. Matt knows a lot about the stuff that Zawinul played. Use of the synthesizer was integral to the Weather Report sound. Joe Zawinul and Herbie Hancock, I think, were used by a lot of the kind of synth companies at the time to kind of endorse their products. But now, what the synthesizer allows Zawinul to do, it allows him to create a huge sound, a kind of big band sound, and it's no coincidence that Peter Erskine was a big band drummer. But without, like, you know, without a 15-piece band, just using all the new sounds made available by the new technology. And in addition to that, we see a move away from this improvisation. In the case of Pharaoh's Dance, they're in their pretty chaotic, intense improvisation, collective improvisation, right to the other extreme, where suddenly everything becomes contained and composed. Now, you see, when we think of a composition, we think of like of a Beethoven symphony or something like that. What we're going to hear now are composed pieces, but they're relatively short pieces, just using very simple materials, lots of repetition, and I talk about the minimal style. The composition is also in a kind of contemporary sense. It's as if these musicians have taken the kind of the format, the jazz format, instrumentally, and they've taken parts of the jazz idiom, kinds of chords that you use, but they've done that and to achieve a whole different end. An end that is far removed from what we normally understand as being jazz. I'm going to play you three tracks now by Weather Report. They hardly contain any improvisation at all. These have been worked out. I can remember when I first started going onto YouTube, I had a little bit of an exchange. You know, I quite enjoy adding comments at the bottom. I mean, but most of the comments, of course, as you know, are complete trouble or written by idiots. But I mean, occasionally people will make very intelligent and important points. So, for example, someone commented on Pharaoh's Dance not that long ago. He had pointed out the exact places where Taylor McCarrow had edited. So anyway, so this guy was, I was enthusing, and this guy was saying, you know, Joe Zawinul, he worked out every note. And this was, of course, an exaggeration. And, you know, I was a bit alarmed, because I was used to early Weather Report, where there's a lot of improvisation. But it is very interesting. It took me a while to reconcile myself to this idea. I came to this music, you know, with a kind of jazz mentality, you know, immersed in the cult of the solo. And I was hearing this music, and I said, wow, this is nice music, this is beautiful music. And then it suddenly kind of dawned on me, but this isn't improvised. It is improvisatory. That is, it is sometimes played as if in a kind of, as if it were improvised, but it's not actually. This is music that is worked out. Okay, Matt, let's hear, this is a track from the Weather Report album, Night Passage, 79, I think it was made. It's called Dream Clock. Here, I've notated the tenor sax entrance. Ba, 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 da, da, dia. Again, very important use of rests. And then look at this main theme, which Wayne Short plays lots of. I talk about an antecedent. Ba, ba, da, ba, da. Ba, ba, da, da, ba, da, di. Not hurried, not virtuosic, you very clever use of motives, every note being put to good account. Nothing improvised here. Nothing improvised. You might ask, how do I know that? I often say to my classes, okay, how do you, jazz is all about improvisation. Well, how do you know it's improvised? Answer, you don't. You don't. We assume, we might make an inference. Oh, this is jazz. It has to be improvised. We don't know for sure. I didn't know for sure that this was improvised until I heard other versions of it, like some string arrangements for orchestra, and it's verbatim, you know, note for note. Again, Matt, let's have it. Thank you. let's go straight into the three flowers. Shorter, he's still alive. It is late 80s by now. He forged a reputation for himself for the, in the 1960s. Well, in the 50s, he was with Art Blakey. In the 60s, he was with Miles Davis. Did a whole range of albums, but very much within a kind of hard rock style. And then moved into this new area that we're exploring. So, I mean, again, you know, someone who's immersed in the jazz idiom, but then somehow sort of tired of it for various reasons and went into something new. Although, interestingly enough, his most recent stuff, he's gone back to improvising. And that's from an album called Black Market. Okay, one more track. This is a track called Palladium, also by Wayne Shorter. This is a lead sheet. This is the kind of jazz and rock musicians don't use scores, they use lead sheets. So it's a kind of sort of reduced scores, if you like, in which the main elements of the piece are set out. What we have here is an intro. Followed by, this is a riff and the bass line. Now notice, this is quite a complex bass line. Earlier on, we had Dave Holland going boom, boom, boom. Clearly, this is something, you know, of a different order altogether. On top of that, we have this riff, bump, 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 bump. And musically, again, and that's the theme, musically, sorry, getting a bit technical again, notice how the riff, the keyboard riff and the bass line, they link up at various parts, in various phases. And notice also how the bass line links in with the melody. One of the most important aspects of funk or funk-derived music like this is it's a kind of a layering, it's a kind of perhaps harking back to kind of sort of polyrhythms or something like that. But you've got these kind of these lines, these various layers of musical activity, which on one hand are sort of independent, but then at the various critical junctures they coincide. You know, so you have on the one hand you have a sense of kind of busyness and each kind of melodic line kind of maintaining its own trajectory, but at the same time everyone playing together, creating this kind of this groove. To the groove again, and then just quickly. Oh yeah, okay. The melody. Here comes. This is the theme. This is all happening together. By the way, it's not very apparent. Notice how the theme is a kind of. It's like a kind of an echo of the riff coming. In each instance, the first two notes of the melody come just a fraction after the riff. So, you know, creating again a sense of kind of independence and at the same time, you know, further rhythmic complexity. And then just finally, the theme, this is an amazing theme. It's a theme that comes around several times and a kind of something else happens towards the end. I'll come to that. But Wayne Shorter ingeniously, he'll play the theme, and then you think it's as if the music's kind of moving away, and then suddenly the theme returns. And then you have the theme, and you say, oh, that's familiar. And then the music sort of seems to kind of move off in another direction. You think there's something else, and then the theme reappears again. The theme is a kind of call and response format. You'll hear this response. It comes all the way through, and it's invariably a kind of a response to this. Just simple kind of elements used to create, you know, a tune that is composed. Please note on this track, this is the last track that we're going to listen to, please notice also the role of percussion. The percussion here is very busy and very important. Now, this is where we come to the quiz time. Okay, there will be a palladium, by the way, it's like a kind of a protector or a guardian. It's a kind of ancient Greek, derived from an ancient Greek term, Pallas, I think. Someone could correct me, was a goddess who oversaw Troy or something like that. So that's the title of the track, and that's what it means. Now, the second theme, this is the question I'm putting to you all. This is the quiz. This is the quiz time. The second theme is ingenious. It flows quite seamlessly from the first one. It's much more slow moving, but it is very familiar. And I want putting it to you. I'll tell you. I'll indicate when it comes in. But I'll be interested to know if any of you can actually recognize where that theme comes from. There are a couple of clues. One is that it's very topical at the moment. Hint, hint, hint. Also, here's Ben. That's another clue. All right. Let's hear Palladium. And off we go.
Thank you.
ideas? Wow, okay. Well, there are three of you. All right. Very good. Very good. There we go. Yes, right. And yeah, I mean, how I can, I don't know, if I were a kind of rigorous musicologist, I would find out, you know, perhaps way shorter, perhaps the band was on tour, they were in London, and you heard the chime, and you thought, oh, I'm going to put this into a tune. Okay, that wraps it up. I'm sorry, it's well over time, as usual. But anyway, I hope I've given you just some kind of glimpse into what at the time was a very significant offshoot of jazz. An offshoot is the operative word. In these last three examples, it's jazz, it's in a kind of contemporary jazz idiom, but notice that the role of improvisation has been circumscribed. In that last track, there were like sort of little bits and pieces, but it was nothing rigorous. The focus of the music is not the improvised solo. And to be absolutely honest, sometimes I find that very liberating. Right, thank you very much. Let's put some light on. How does it sound to your ears? I don't think it's aged at all. You see, I don't know, but look, I'm biased. I mean, the whole reason I made this selection was because for 45 years, I've been listening to the music, and every time I come back to it and I hear something new, it still strikes me as being fresh and innovative. Particularly given the way that jazz has just become submerged in this kind of dogma, this kind of this slavish adherence to kind of, you know, improvisatory doctrine. You know, there's a term in Cape Town, you've probably come across it, they talk about the jazz police. You know, and if you're not operating outside of the kind of idiom you regarded as a kind of apostate, well, long live apostasy, I say. Yes.
What do you think led to the cult of the soul, that obsession with everyone getting their chance to?
Well, you see, good question. New Orleans jazz, swing jazz. The improvised solo was integrated into the performance and the arrangement as a whole. It was partly political. It has to do with the emergence of bebop. Bebop famously was forged in the course of jam sessions, after-hours jam sessions in nightclubs. Big band musicians who'd spent the nights, you know, playing for dancers now would congregate at these clubs, and they would exalt this art of the solo, of improvisation, and raise it to, you know, a kind of an important level. And that became bebop. And there's a whole lot of other stuff that goes with it. Musicians like Duke Ellington, Fats Waller, they were regarded as sellouts because they were pandering to popular taste. and that included like sort of white taste, and a whole new generation of musicians emerged that were keen, they were at pains to distance themselves from the cultural mainstream. Bebop in extremis didn't last for very long, and you had cool jazz and hard bop emerging as much more listener-friendly responses to bebop, but the kind of the dogma remained. Bebop was consciously elitist. They wanted to be special, and this is a disease which has afflicted jazz to this day. You know, jazz musicians think that they're part of this kind of the special sort of family. You know, it's really like a kind of religion. I think jazz as an idiom has paid the price. People aren't talking about jazz coming back. You're not talking about, like, you know, people hearing George Benson or Maynard Ferguson in the course of the day. Jazz, I believe, has painted itself back in a corner, and it's actually going backwards. I think jazz musicians urgently need to attend to the music of bands like Weatherhill. But of course they don't, because they've been completely
Thank you so much. What role has recordings played? Because, the very intention of improvising and making something spontaneous and live and immediate and to just happen, the moment you record it, it can be copied or written down and then composed. And, you know, I don't know, the key joke to learn thing, you can. I don't know if it was an improvised concert in Cologne, but you can buy the score for it, and you'll see on YouTube 20 people playing exactly the same, you know, same movement that he played. And it's, I wonder if it's just because we recorded it and we've removed the immediacy and the spontaneity.
Yeah, I think that's a problem. I think that the fact, the academization of jazz has a lot to do with it. As soon as you start teaching things at universities, you know, you kill them stone dead. interestingly enough, Zalman, whose composition we heard, Dream Clock, his compositions weren't originally composed. They were a bit like Miles, or Miles in the hand of his producer. Zalmor used to, you know, he had a studio with all its keyboards, as we saw there, and he would just jam on his own, and he would record his improvisations. He would record them, and then, they, exactly as you say, they would then become compositions. There would be something, there would be a part of his improvisation that he really liked. And this is definitely an echo of Taylor McGuire and Miles. And then he would use that material as composition. But I mean, look, this is in Western classical music. I mean, you know, at one stage the art of improvisation was alive and well. We still have plenty of pieces with titles like Impromptu. You know, Mozart was a brilliant improviser. You know, so similarly with those. You know, those musicians, we can imagine, we can sort of, you know, speculate that they would spend a lot of time improvising, you know, on their own, and then they would come across something and think, I really like this, I'm going to keep this. Or they would somehow kind of fix their compositions. But yes, look, I mean, yeah, recording, you know, I don't know if you ever came across that book, The Recording Angel. It discusses, it was written a long time ago, but it discusses the rather unfortunate influence that recording has had on music, and the recording becomes something sui generis. It's true. But then you see, on the other hand, I mean, look what Miles Davis did. It mattered not a fig to him whether the tape was running or not. He would say, come guys, let's just play. I mean, you can hear, like, you know, just, I mean, the spontaneity on Pharaoh's Dance and that kind of vibe that they were achieving spontaneously was like, was terrific. But yeah, look, well, you see, this is the point. Recording, whether we like it or not, recording and technology has become a part of the scene. You know?
I've got a question. It's a linguistic one, and I'm not sure if it's relevant, but I can't help but ask it. You spoke about groove in the very beginning and gave us kind of a good musical definition, but where does the sort of etymology come from in calling it a groove? Is there something related to music or the original meaning of a groove, or is it just a pure coincidence?
It's an informal colloquial term that was used just because existing terminology and vocabulary just couldn't quite capture what people were talking about. And as I say, this is a huge problem. People who are steeped in classical music will struggle to understand what a groove is. Unless, of course, you check out the American minimalists, people like Steve Reich in particular. Steve Reich understood what a groove was, and his music is all groove based. But look, we're trying to use vocabulary that's been used to kind of describe one musical tradition, and now suddenly we've got to try and describe a whole range of other stuff. Like the word, my pet hate is the word syncopation. It is such a crude term, and yet it is still used. It is a racist, Eurocentric, offensive term. It is a term used to describe what African-American musicians were doing, because what they were doing was rhythmic. African musicians didn't enjoy the on-beat. They liked cross-rhythms and rhythmic interest, and they brought that to ragtime, they brought that to marching band music, and that became ragtime. Ragtime meaning ragged time, i.e. these guys can't play it properly, they're ragging it, i.e. they're kind of sort of messing around with it. It's awful. The groove is the best we've got, and even there's even talk of groovology. But look, Andrew, to be honest, I'm sure that research and thinking about this has come a long way, and I can't pretend that I am au fait with it. But a groove is something that you feel, and I mean, I could see people in the audience were relating to the groove on Palladium with that like really intense percussion, and I mean, that's a groove-based piece par excellence, and with these beautiful simple melodies on top. But that's a good question. Yes, Aidan.
I was just wondering if jazz will ever really be able to emerge from the corners painted itself in. I mean, besides from, you know, universities and institutions like that being very bebop-centered and elitist in many ways, even just in terms of the commercial scene, actually, any sort of innovation or changes being rewarded, I suppose, so that musicians can actually continue doing them.
I think it's happening, but people aren't calling it jazz anymore. I think jazz has been absorbed into several contemporary idioms. My daughter's boyfriend is gone, but he plays me a lot of stuff with jazz influence. There's a DST TV audio channel called Groove Lounge, which is basically kind of electronic music. But the influence of jazz on that, and indeed the influence of musicians or bands like Weather, of course, is palpable. So people are using jazz, but it's not cool jazz. It's being absorbed into other kinds of videos, while jazz musicians still kind of strut around, you know, pretending they're important. No, look, I think jazz is being maintained, but in creative ways that lie outside of the jazz kind of idiom.
At this juncture in your career, what has always attracted me to jazz, and I'm a very classical background myself, is the spontaneity. How does one teach spontaneity?
Right, well, throw away the music. You know, music education today is wedded to the score, to what is written down. People can't, if you ask them to play something that they, of their own pat, you know, 9 times out of 10, they'll just go into kind of into a tizz. They'll be gripped by this terrible, this panic, as if having to actually produce music that as isn't written down is just something kind of rather alien. It's really unfortunate, but we're looking now at like a deep problem with music education, frankly. And it's not just, it doesn't just have to do with improvisation, it has to do with actually just creating new music. But I think improvising, as I've touched on, is one of the ways in which we can move towards creating something new. You know, you doodle away on your own in the practice room, doodle and you strike on something, you think, I like that, and then that becomes the basis for something. But to answer your question, throw away the score, throw away the music, just doodle. And then, you know, after a while, your doodling will become very serious. And, you know, they will be like John Coltrane, and you'll doodle for 18 hours a day, and be able to play 40-minute improvised solos.
Okay, thanks very much, Rick. I started this evening off with some notes. I guess that's composition, so I'm going to repeat it. And then Rick's just gone on without a note inside, so I guess he's Miles Davis. Went to a conference a few years ago by, I think it was a teach conference, in Leonard Prague. He did this amazing thing where he pulled out a cello, and then he set up, and he got ready to play, and then he never played. And then he said to the audience, well, what do you think the relationship is between the cello and me? And it was clear, just from the way that he handled the thing, that it wasn't something that was incidental, it was something that was essential to him. And I mean, Rick is a jazz performer, and he has spoken about jazz for just over an hour and a half. And it is so clear that it is something that is essential to him. And I think it was just absolutely beautiful. So thank you very much, Rick.
Thank you. Undivided attention. Don't talk to people. Switch off the lights. Just focus on the music. Otherwise, you're not giving the music its due.